Good morning. A couple of announcements. First is concerning the bulletin. We're going to make some changes in order. After our opening, we'll sing the hymn, which is listed after the sermon, which is... we're just starting. Okay, which is Come Sing to God. It's a musical rendition of Psalm 30, that of which we know the tune, but we'll sing that there. And then after the sermon, I'm going to go ahead and pray our morning prayer. Then we'll sing Amazing Grace. We'll announce this as we go along. You don't have to remember it. I wrote it down. I'm learning and close. So those are just announcements on the order of the service. A note that there is Bible study tonight here at the church, also will be available by Zoom if you like. I have other announcements. They go from the good to the sad, which is reflective of the life of the church and the life of all of us. We had a rummage sale yesterday at which all we did was ask for donations, and we got $1,600 in donations. And we're finding increasingly that this works. I think we learned this with the spaghetti dinner. When it was free, nobody came. When it was a dollar, lots of people came. It works with soup. It worked with the rummage sale, that we give what we have to those people, and people give us what they have, and it works. So that's good news for us. I have prayer requests for four people: Ron McDivitt, Pete Hunt, Larry Miller, and Bill Dixon. And the sad news is that Eleanor Zerbini passed this morning just a little bit after 7 o'clock. And that's all the details we have right now. We'll keep you filled in as we know more later. But again, this is reflective of life. And so I would ask that you turn to page 3 to the call to worship. O come, let us sing to the Lord, and shout with joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us worship God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, abolished death. Let us pray. Almighty God, you built your church on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be a holy temple, acceptable to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. And now we will sing together, please, hymn 181 in the blue hymnals in front of you. 181. Thank you. now let us pray. Gracious God, we would ask that you break through the barrier that separates us from you, that you open our minds to think in new ways, to see in new ways, to believe in new ways, that we might be renewed by the words we hear and the thoughts we think, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 30. It is printed here in the bulletin, beginning at the top of page 4, if you would like to follow along with us. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his saints, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. By your favor, O Lord, you made my mountain stand strong. You hid your face. I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cry, and to the Lord I plead for mercy. What profit is there in my death? If I go down to the pit, will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned for me my mourning into dancing. You have loosed my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness, that my glory may sing your praise and be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. So let's take a few moments now and think what the writer of this psalm may be telling us as we too come before the Lord our God in silence. And now, Lord our God, continue to speak to us. Fill us with your Spirit and be present to us, that once again we might hear thunder and see lightning in each of your words. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We have a second reading read today by our lector, Cheryl Stang.
Good morning. This is a reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. And when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I touch even his garments, I will be made well." And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion of people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. Here end the readings. Thanks be to God.
Where does the church fit in today's world? Okay. And as I speak, as I so often do, especially as I begin, I'm speaking very broadly of our culture, both within and outside the church, actually. So when I ask, where does the church fit in today's world, I'm speaking to myself and to all of us, and more particularly to the world that finds the church increasingly irrelevant to them. The church in so many ways has been pushed to the edges of society. It's more than that church attendance is down, it's that people go other places first. They seek whatever they're seeking almost anywhere but the church, and if there is a last resort, then they come. There are a lot of reasons for this. I don't know how many tens of thousands of gallons of ink have been spilt trying to explain this, but the one that makes the most sense to me is that the church is no longer speaking to today's world. It's speaking to a time and place and culture that used to exist and no longer exists. And we're still talking as if it existed, and it's no wonder we're not being heard. We just had this conversation last night, and I've had it with a lot of people. For so many people, there no longer exists even the possibility of a sacred dimension to life. And if God exists at all, God is distant and has very little to do with them, if anything. And so I think it's a very serious question to ask, where do we fit into this world today? After we do our fundraising and after we do our charity work, what do we offer the world? Or in a world finding God irrelevant, if there even is God, how do we function? So I want to begin with the Bible. Just like a single shot 22, almost everybody owns one. Somewhere tucked away in a closet in almost every house in America. Yeah. But almost everyone has a Bible. It's still a perennial bestseller. We give them away in our churches. We give them away anywhere we can. And you see them in, laying on seats in cars. You see them in homes. You see them everywhere you go. They even sell them in Walmart. And they might be the venerable old King James. They might be some new snazzy teen Bible, women's Bible, men's Bible, addiction Bible. The words inside are the same, by the way. And if you don't own one, you can get it on the internet in less than 7 milliseconds, I believe. All of it. On an old phone. So everybody has one or has access to one. And so one solution, I suppose, is to begin with the Word of God and say, well, why don't you go and read the Bible? And what I'm going to say is not sarcasm. These are all things that people have either come to me with or I know of persons who have been challenged by this directly. People have gone and read the Bible, and they read something like, maybe they open to Psalms as we did this morning, and they read, God is a rock. So what do you do with that? And then if they poke around a little bit, and I don't know what guides people, but they seem to come to this. They may read that the rock is Christ, as it says in Corinthians, or God is not only a rock, but a rock of offense, and boy, do the BS detectors start to go up at that point. Well, let's try again, and perhaps we will read, God will hide us in the shadow of his wings. And as one young wag said, well, now we have a flying rock. Perhaps these are just excuses not to go deeper and not to dig in and not to discover what's really being said. But for some people, particularly if you have a very literalist mind or if you go to a church that has a very literal reading and that's what you've been taught all your life, what do you do with this? And we find that from this flying rock we can get both water and honey. See how hard it is? Oh, and I am the rock, the womb that gives you birth. See, now we're into feminist language. And one of the favorites that somehow people find this, God throws great stones down from the sky on Israel's enemies. And they're disconnected at this point. So let's pause and take a breath and say, well, most of that's in the Old Testament. Open the New Testament and we read the story of the tombs opening up and ghosts walking in the streets of Jerusalem and, oh my. Let's just stop for a minute. Clearly, these are cherry-picked, as they say. We can take other sets and come up with other scenarios, and we can do this for a long, long time. Some churches have gone the route of God wants you to be fill in the blank. Rich, famous, pretty, successful, wealthy, happy. They picked a different set of verses. And at some point, life will snap shut the door, and we will discover that no amount of money or fame or success will keep us from suffering. No amount will stop the flow of life from impacting us, often very severely. And it's here that we can turn to the Psalms, which cover life at its extremities. When we are pushed to the edges, we need a place to go. And it's the Psalms that can take us there and bring us back to a good center. So for just a minute, I want to look at Psalm 30. Try to put it in context first. There's a little heading in the Bible. We didn't put it in the bulletin, but it's in most of your Bibles. It says it's a Psalm of David, a song sung at the dedication of the temple. David's life went from high points to low points to high points to low points. His family was spectacularly dysfunctional. He won his kingdom. He lost his kingdom. His life was just a challenge. And in all probability, he wrote this psalm when he looked back over his life and saw the ebb and flow of how God had worked in his life. It's also a song, it's still sung to this day in memory of the dedication of the temple. After the first Hanukkah, the temple was rededicated, and it's very likely this song was sung because Israel can look back over their life and they can see their high points and their low points, and they see how God has worked. And so I think it's a psalm that we can use because our life will take on this same kind of ebb and flow over the course of its years. The turning points are in verse 6, 7 and 11. In verse 6, we'll just take David as the writer. David says, "In my prosperity, I shall never be moved." These are the good times. These are the times when everything is flowing smoothly. These are the times when the bills are being paid, when we are healthy, when life takes on a nice, shiny hue for us. And actually, these are not very interesting times. They're not exciting. But we've all had them. We've all had the times when we won, when we were successful, when we got what we wanted. You can pick them out. They're also dangerous times because they're the times when we forget that we need God. And when Bitcoin used to take 10,000 of them to buy a cup of coffee, and even today it's selling at 24,000 for one. You can buy a car with one. Okay. It's really hard to see. Wherever you think the economy may be going, it's really hard to see bad times in today's world because most of us are pretty well situated. In my prosperity, I thought I shall never be moved. Life is good. And then in verse 7, you hid your face. I was dismayed. These are the times we all face when the bottom drops out of our life. I'm not going to try to bring back any memories or delineate any of them. We all know where they are. We all have had that shock, every one of us. But this is where divine action begins to take place for us. This is when we know that we truly need God. That whatever we may have done before this, whether it's physical or intellectual or emotional or spiritual, we need God to strengthen us. And nothing else is going to work in the depths right here. Bernard Anderson wrote a book on the Psalms, Out of the Depths I Called to Thee. And then verse 11, you have turned for me my mourning into dancing. The times come back. The good times come back. It's a cycle, and we all go through it. So now I want to go back almost to the beginning, to this idea that God is a rock. This is clearly a metaphor, as so much of Scripture is. Metaphor, symbol, signs even. And if nothing else, it should give us the idea that maybe we need to read Scripture a little bit differently. That the hyper-literalist readings that we've inherited don't work either. God is a rock in that God is stable, God is there, God is something we can lean against. There's a great deal here that this idea opens up. And again, we're just pushing the metaphor here. It's a rock from which refreshing water can flow. The stream of mercy, compassion, forgiveness, love, hope can flow from this rock as honey that sustains us. And even sometimes at just the right time, big rocks are hurled down out of the sky on our enemies and we can kind of skate through. It happens. Just not always the way we expect. These are such rich metaphors for how God acts in our lives. And understanding that they're metaphors that were first created 3,000 years ago doesn't mean that we can't transport them into our own lives and find the times when God was the only rock we could cling to. And we were refreshed. And so the church, in its charitable acts, does great and wonderful things. We feed and clothe and bring health to probably millions of people around the world now. Much of what we do is life-saving for people. There are times when we need more than that, or different than that. Particularly in our rich American culture, what we seem to need the most in these times of unsettled or dislocation or trauma is someone's presence, someone who will come and share the time with us. You know, the Psalms don't say, oh, it's going to be okay. They say there are tough times, and sometimes we just need somebody to share the tough times with us and to just sit with us and to just be with us. Not to cheer us up, but to cry with us. And sometimes we can be that to someone else. Sometimes what is needed is just presence, a sharing of a part of who we are. and I've heard young people say this, I just need somebody to understand me. That's all. There's a great loss of meaning in the world. Sometimes I just need somebody to understand me. This is what I believe the church can bring to the world today. That we can be those who are with people when they get to the edges and there's nothing there. Or when we get to the edges and there's nothing there and we need somebody. I think this is who we are being called to be in the world as it is now and the future that's unfolding. Is to simply go out and be with people. Then we can tell them the story. You know, Jesus went through this. I don't know when this comes. You'll know. He had a day when he rode into town on a donkey, and everybody in that town cheered for him. And 3 days later, he was hanging on a cross. And 3 days later, he was resurrected. Same story. Psalm 30, Jesus' story. Same story. It's our story. It's the world's story. What we can bring people is resurrection. Let's pray. Gracious God, resurrect us so we can raise others in Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and pray our morning prayer for ourselves and the world here. Then we'll have the praise team come up and sing Amazing Grace, Benediction, closing song. So it's prayer, Amazing Grace, Benediction, closing song. Let's pray. Holy God, here we are, your people. We still believe, we still care, we still hope. We still seek your presence, knowing that no matter how confused things might be, you are the rock that gives stability to the church. In Christ, you are the cornerstone on which we are built. You are the living grace that is poured into our lives at each and every moment. And knowing that you are here with us, we can speak openly, and we can think freely, and we can be your people. And in this richness of knowing that you have emptied yourself to be one of us, we know that we are understood, perhaps more than we understand ourselves. So that we are freed, being freed in Christ to be with others. And when the time comes, to tell your story. And so we thank you for this grace to be called into your church and to be your people. We bring before you this morning a few who find themselves at that point where life has suddenly become traumatic. We pray for Ron McDivitt, for Pete Hunt, for Larry Miller, for Bill Dixon. We pray for the family of Eleanor and her friends, and those of us who have shared life with her throughout the life of the church. We pray, Lord, for those who are confused, who find life meaningless, who struggle, even in their success, to find joy, that we might one day sit down with them and say, "Let me tell you a story." We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. And now, if the praise team would come forward, we will sing with them "Amazing Grace." The words are here in the bulletin on page 3.
Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.